finished up Tiger King, I just want to remind America that anybody who thinks they're sure that they know Carol Baskin killed her husband is going beyond the facts. Anyway, we're into a new chapter. This is chapter 13. Chapter 12 and 13 will make up your next exam, but that exam is not for a while yet. There are four separate days for discussion on chapter 13. Today is only the first day. We will wrap that up next Monday. That is when the chapter 13 quiz will be due. It is open now, but it is not closed until midnight a week from today. After which, your next exam will be that Wednesday. But anyway, here we go. Let's get to it. Chapter 13, therapies. We talked about disorders last time. We talked about just about everything that we wanted to say in terms of the major disorders and some of the more interesting ones. And now it's going to be about therapies. Therapies are not necessarily going to track disorder for disorder. This is how you treat this. This is how you treat this. This is how you treat this. That might be something more that you get with a medical degree, but therapy is much more oriented towards how you are doing therapy as opposed to what it is in particular that you are treating. And so therapy is kind of broken down into several different ways to intervene with someone who might qualify as having a disorder. As I said last time around, the experience of symptoms is the end of a long causal chain that feeds back into itself, which can begin with events that happen outside of you and that impact you. They come in and as information and create your mental state, interpretation, and your attitude, your personality. All these things are mental phenomena that help to determine how the environment is going to impact you, that becomes a physical and chemical arrangement of your body, where increasing or decreasing serotonin or epinephrine or whatever it is. And then those physical and chemical carriers of the cause will end up showing up in symptoms. So your mood, your behavior, your ability to function. And each one of those points in the causal chain is a potential place for intervention. So there's a few things that are going to be talked about here in this chapter that go into this model, different ways to intervene in symptoms at different points in the causal chain. The events external to you that have an effect on your mental state, those are things that can be manipulated in behavioral therapy. They can also be things that can be changed or improved to improve your mental health by going out there and changing your environment. Working directly on the mental part of how you interpret events and how you manage the information coming in is the purview of traditional talk therapy, which we're going to spend a lot of time on. But after that, when mental interpretation of events become neurotransmitters, there is a place to intervene there also with biomedical therapies, different medications, different drugs. And then finally, this is not something necessarily is focused on in your book, but I want to just touch on it real quick. When you have symptoms, when you have the actual behaviors or thoughts that qualify you for a disorder, there is another approach to therapy which doesn't involve any of the other points in the causal chain, but just focuses directly on what the world would be like if those symptoms resolved. So I'll talk about that solution-focused therapy a little bit later. In general, there is a more sweeping topic to be done with all of these points in the causal chain, which is the overall effectiveness of therapy. And that's also a really interesting talk as well. How effective is therapy? How effective are different therapies? And how effective are therapies when it comes to matching them up with particular disorders or problems? I would be remiss if I didn't mention a little bit about the breakdown of professionals who work in the arena of psychotherapy. Some of you might be interested in getting into one of these fields. And so I want to run them down for you again. The psychiatrists, I list them first. I don't want to put value judgments on people, but generally they are considered to be the people who are at the top of the food chain in psychotherapy, probably get paid the most, probably give the most orders, but the role is actually pretty specific. The psychiatrist has a medical degree. They're a medical doctor, just like a surgeon or anything else. They had to go through medical school and just ended up focusing on mental health as their specialty. But by virtue of their medical background, they are able to administer and prescribe medications, which is what they end up doing. Because they are uniquely qualified to do that, that ends up being a lot of their time. Clinical psychologists and counseling psychologists are both people with PhDs. The clinical psychologist has a tendency to deal more with the severe, perhaps institutionalized clientele. A counseling psychologist has a tendency, and these are all just tendencies, has a tendency to see clients who are still out and about in their communities working, but could just be functioning better. Counselors, those are people with master's degrees. We'll do a whole lot of the clinical work out there. A master's degree is really all that you need in order to be an effective, accessible, insured, independent practitioner of psychotherapy. There's a case to be made, an argument to be made that a PhD is really kind of overkill if you want to be out there doing direct client work. So if you have a master's in counseling, you can get accreditation and licensing as an LPC, a licensed professional counselor. Social work is also an avenue into doing mental health counseling. So if you have a master's degree in social work, you can go through the licensing program and get yourself an LCSW, a licensed clinical social worker designation. There are also paraprofessionals, people who do not have advanced degrees, but who nevertheless do a lot of the direct contact work with people who are in need of mental health services. And a relatively new designation for that is the Qualified Mental Health Professional, the QMHP. Virginia, that is something that we've been asking for people for a while. And it's something that you can get with just a bachelor's or even less as you work with a organization that would be willing to support you getting your QMHP. You can actually start on a career right there without an advanced degree. There are other kinds of therapists with different designations. There's the ABA therapist, applied behavior analysis, and many different flavors. But these are the basic people that operate in the therapeutic world. I will tell you something right off the bat before we get to the evaluation of therapies at the end. Any one of these people is likely to be a helpful person for you if you decided that you would want to become a client. There is surprisingly little effect of how much or what kind of formal education somebody has had, as long as they are adhering to and practicing the basic principles of appropriate professional psychotherapy. So if you ever think, oh, all I can get into is with a social worker, I don't really respect social work, are they kind of goofy, and LCSW, now I'll hold out for a PhD, you're not really doing yourself any favors. You could have had a good time spent therapeutically with somebody with a master's in social work without holding out for what was supposed to be better, but probably really isn't. Anyway, little soapbox there. Let's get into the kookiest of the stuff and we'll work our way from there. Psychoanalysis, the treatment method laid down by Freud himself, has a process by which people can become healed well, get rid of their symptoms. As I said, Freud was kind of a specialist in hysteria. People who were experiencing physical symptoms for mental disorders. But his basic idea, as we learned back in the personality chapter, was that illness or your inability to function was the product of unconscious conflicts, that there were things going on below the level of consciousness in your head that when they got expressed to the real world in a way that you didn't necessarily understand, would cause you to be non-functional. So there were unconscious conflicts between your ego and your id, or your superego and your ego, and that or fixation at a state of development, and these were a problem for you. So the cure for the psychoanalyst is to bring you on a journey where your unconscious conflicts are made conscious, where you learn about yourself, you learn about the functioning of the personality structures, and you gain insight into how that story applies to you. Freud really was convinced that it was the same story for everyone, but you had to fill in the blanks for who and what was filling what role for you in that story in order to understand who it is that you are and how it is that you are functioning. The therapist serves in this take on therapy as a relatively neutral, emotionally neutral and blank slate presence, but also an expert guide when the time is right for educating you about how the psychoanalytic story applies to you. We'll talk a little bit more about the process of therapy on the next slide. But a healthy person, a person who has finished their journey in psychotherapy, if that's ever possible, has understood their conflicts and has taken appropriate defense mechanism for unavoidable psychic energy and expression. And the best defense mechanism is sublimation. So you're able to take the anxieties and the conflicts that are occurring in your subconscious and make them into expressions of productivity by working them off and channeling that energy into something productive. What kind of techniques did Freud use as a psychoanalyst? Well, a couple of them are famous. One is free association, where basically the therapist just lets you talk about whatever it is that you want. Just say, what does this remind you of? Does it remind you of anything else? Does it remind you of anything else? Just go right on. Word association was another one that goes into free association sometimes. You'd say, I mean, why don't you tell me the first word that comes to your mind when I say wall? Okay. How about dog, grass, cloud, paper? I mean, and people would just say the first thing that came to mind as a way of kind of loosening them up and getting some insight into what was all happening automatically deeper inside their brain. It was the therapist's job to interpret what those responses meant. Maybe they wouldn't share that information right away. Maybe they'd tuck it away for an interpretation later. But it was all about the therapist getting in a little bit of insight into what was happening automatically below the level of your consciousness as a client. Dream analysis. Freud said that dreams were the road to the unconscious. And so if you went to your therapist and started talking about what it is that you had for a dream that you can remember, that would be a rich place for interpretation. Dreams were made up, as far as Freud was concerned, with manifest and then latent content. Manifest content was what the person reported the dream was actually about. Latent content was the interpretation for what anxiety was coming through in the manifest content. The manifest stuff was literal, the latent stuff was interpretation. There's a running joke in my family, between my wife and I, where somebody will have a dream and I will say, yes, I had that dream last night again where I was in class, but I had ignored all of my coursework up until the time where I had to submit three papers on the readings that I had failed to do, and it's all due tomorrow by noon. It feels like I'm still in college. And Jane goes, oh, why must your dreams be so cryptic? Well, yeah, sometimes latent content seems pretty obvious. Nevertheless, there's still no good reason to believe that dreams are particularly meaningful, but we are very, very good as human beings at putting rich interpretations on things. Anyway, the Freudian therapist would say, oh, I can help you out with that. I know what the content of dreams mean, and run with that to help you understand what's going on in your own subconscious. What happens during the course of psychotherapy? Well, there has a couple of different phases. In the first phase that any psychoanalytic therapist should expect is the phase of resistance. The unconscious is not particularly interested in becoming conscious. There's a reason why it's all hidden. There's a reason it's all buried. It's very threatening to the person. That's why we suppress it. That's why we ignore it. And so there's going to be some resistance from any client for bringing that unconscious content to the surface. So resistance might be like trying to hide information or joking about it or derail the therapy some way, not show up, being late, canceling. To the psychoanalyst, these are all just expressions of resistance, and it's perfectly normal. The next thing that happens when resistance phase is getting towards the end is transference, where a patient's feelings for the things that are important to them, the things that are happening to them, become about the therapist. So if that person's major issue, the problem they're working on right then, is the inability to be angry when they really ought to be, they're appropriately angry at somebody but can't really express that in real life, they will start becoming angry at their therapist. Their therapist will take on the role of who or whatever it is that they need to work on. Interestingly enough, oftentimes the major work, as the psychoanalyst would consider it, is work repairing or rehashing your relationship with your parents. So your therapist will often end up being treated as a substitute for a parent with whom you have lingering or unresolved conflict. So if you're a woman, the therapist suddenly becomes your father. If you're a male, the therapist becomes your mother. It's very, very strange. Now, the other thing is there's this also thing called countertransference, which is the idea that the therapist, while being a human being as well, will begin to misplace their process as a therapist onto their client, start putting their client in a role that isn't appropriate for their client, but it is a working out of the therapist's own stuff. So therapists have to be keeping a close eye on their own process and perhaps having a therapist of their own to make sure that they're maintaining a professional operating relationship with their clients. Transference is a thing that signals that a client is ready to start with some heavier interpretation of what it is that's going on for them and really bring that unconscious up to the surface. Coming up here is a video. Psychotherapy in the psychoanalytic tradition has fallen out of favor. It's still a really rich cultural touchstone, but as a clinical practice, you're not going to find many people who are practicing it. So more like during the 40s, 50s, 60s, would you find people who were committed to the idea of psychoanalysis? And so this is kind of a promotional video, or a what's happening now in the latest techniques of medicine, demonstrating a ridiculously clean process for someone who finds an issue, spends some time in therapy, has an insight, resolves it, feels better, and goes home. It is the absolute perfect expression of a home run bit of psychotherapy.
Today, America's psychiatrists have long waiting lists of such maladjusted people.
But why do I keep getting so depressed, Doctor? That's what I can't figure out.
Let's go over what you've already told me. You're in good physical shape, according to your physician who sent you to me. You say yourself you have no financial or domestic worries. So the causes of your depression must lie elsewhere.
There's got to be some reason why I go through all this mental misery, Doctor.
In order to find out, I suggest we undertake a month or so of exploratory analysis.
From the beginning, in order that the patient under analysis may feel free of constraint, he is placed on a couch and urged to let his mind roam freely. For every slightest thought or random memory may offer some clue to the deeply rooted causes of his illness.
That's odd. I had a sudden glimpse of the time when I was a kid and got stung in the toe by a bee. Oh, my brother laughed at me. But that's beside the point, isn't it?
Psychoanalysis is a long and difficult process of reconstructing from fragmentary recollections a picture giving the patient a correct insight into the forces at work within him and enabling him to deal with his problems realistically.
I had a talk with my brother today. He's in trouble again. No use trying to help him. It's like pouring water down a bottomless well. I hate my brother. Loathe him. Despise him. For 40 years I've been hating him. Well, I never came out and said so before. I always think of him sitting on Mama's lap. She loved him. She just tolerated me. You see what it does to me? It's a fine way for a man in my position to act, isn't it?
When we are little, and get all caught up in violent opposing feelings, we have to let off steam by crying.
Here you are, caught between jealousy, hatred, and yearning, all buried inside. You couldn't kill your brother, though you wanted to. You couldn't take his place with your mother. Storms of rage and fear have been building up in you from that day to this.
Funny. I feel a little better now.
That's not really how it works so much anymore. Psychoanalysis, as I said, has gone out of favor, but we do still have people who practice some version of the old ideas, but they'll have a tendency to call it psychodynamic. The psychodynamic therapist is a lot more active than the kind of just sitting back and listening and allowing for transference therapist of the psychoanalytic tradition. The psychodynamic person is less stuck on the idea that the Freudian story was precisely right. They're not going to insist that people had different stages of development, oral, anal, phallic. They're not going to insist that people had an Oedipus complex. But nevertheless, the ideas of unconscious and conscious and conflict and ego perhaps will be useful terms for them to help figure out how to help their clients. And it's also usually in a much shorter timeline. Traditional psychoanalysis is fairly intense, 3 to 5 times a week, not just a weekly session, but for potentially years for you to kind of meander to the realizations you need for your health. One of the popular applications of psychodynamic psychotherapy in the modern world is this thing called object relations therapy. Object relations comes up a lot of times as a distractor in your quizzes. And so I want to make sure that since we've been throwing it at you for months, you know what it is. Object relations is the idea that one of the good things to focus on in psychotherapy is your relationship to emotionally relevant people in your life. Those people are the objects in object relations. It seems fairly weird to say that, it seems objectifying, but that was just the Freudian turn of phrase, the psychoanalytic and psychodynamic turn of phrase, that the person with whom you potentially have a longstanding emotional problem to sort out was an object that is going to be relevant in therapy. All right. Getting away from the psychoanalytic, psychodynamic traditions, there is the humanist, client-centered, or phenomenologist position. This is a little bit closer to how we tend to see people functioning as therapists in the modern world. But what I'm going to go over with you right now is an extreme version that isn't really widely practiced. But we talked about this a little bit when I went over Carl Rogers in the last chapter or two. But just to remind you, the humanist believes that people are fundamentally good, fundamentally functional, and if left to their own devices, would be growing and spiritual and just absolutely wonderful. So illness, mental illness, would be caused by unfulfilled human potential because people have spent their lives imposing conditions of worth on you. Say, you'll get my positive regard if you do this for me, or if you are this kind of person, and it splits you from who you would actually be because you're trying to meet the desires and the demands of other people. The cure in client-centered humanist therapy is actually something that comes from the client. It doesn't come from the therapist. The client is given an environment and a situation and permission to pursue their authentic selves, and when they've been given that environment with enough time, they will come up with who they actually are. They will come up with their own solutions, and they will feel better by doing the work for themselves. The therapist is not considered an expert in that person's particular life or desires or wants. They just help that person to find themselves. The therapist's role, though, is to be genuine, You can't fake this. You can't lie about it. You can't put on a face. You can't put on a facade. They have to be genuine, empathic, and have unconditional positive regard towards the person. We'll talk about those a little bit later here as well. A person who has achieved mental health is somebody who knows and accepts themselves. They love themselves. They know who they are. They realize that they're flawed, but that doesn't really mean they aren't a valuable person, and they see themselves that way. Why does this particular therapy work according to the therapists and the theorists who practice it? Well, it's a combination of things. The genuineness of the therapist means that the client cannot help believe the therapist's reactions. If that therapist is being genuine, then there must be some reason why they are reacting to their clients so positively, with such unshakable regard for their worth. Empathy, especially accurate empathy, will tell the client another thing, which is that this person isn't giving me positive regard because they've misinterpreted me. They actually understand what I'm experiencing. They actually understand what I'm feeling and who I am, and still they're giving me positive regard. So accurate empathy is something that is very foundational to this style of therapy. And a lot of times it means nothing more than just telling the person back what they've already told you a moment before. It can sound really silly. It can sound actually a bit trite, but in the moment when you're sitting with somebody who is just reflecting your words back to you, it can actually be very powerful and not trite at all. So here's the exchange that was in your book. I want to put it in your ears too. The client says, "This has been such a bad day. I felt ready to cry any minute, and I'm not even sure what's wrong." The therapist says, "You really do feel so bad. The tears just seem to well up inside, and I wonder if it's a little scary to not even know why you feel this way." Oh my God, that's what I just said. That's not genius insight. That is literally just kind of rephrasing the things that the person has just said to you. But you would be surprised sometimes at how powerful it can be for a person's experience to, for a therapist's experience to be reflected back on a client in such a way that that client feels like that they are the center of the therapist's universe for that moment. That it wasn't overinterpreted, that there wasn't extra stuff thrown on, that it didn't become a story about the therapist. If a client tells you something and your response to them is, "Here's what you just said," that is incredibly validating, and it can really launch people in the direction of feeling better. Another thing to talk about when it comes to therapist behavior is congruence. This is a tough one because in order for a therapist to be genuine, they can't be faking around their clients about how they feel or how they're doing. So if a therapist is genuinely feeling awful or having a really bad day or something like that, they can't come in and fake like they're happy to their clients. There has to be a little bit of honesty about what's going on for them. Now, you don't want to make the therapy about the therapist, but the humanist therapist will recognize that somebody who comes in and tries to fake that they're feeling a certain way is going to potentially do a lot of damage to the therapeutic relationship. And finally, I've talked about the unconditional positive regard here. What that is also about is something that is not easy for everybody to do. We love to judge. I love to judge. People love to judge. People love to say that was good, that was bad, you are good, you are bad. But the therapist who is doing humanist and client-centered work can't afford to do that. They have to constantly be focused on the worth of the person in front of them. Now, the distinction there is that you do not have to approve of that person's behavior. You don't have to approve for what they do. You don't have to explain or excuse the actions that they've taken. But you also always have to be giving the message that despite their behavior, the person is worthwhile and worthy of positive regard. Which, again, if you've got a client sitting in front of you who you find absolutely unctuous, gross, creepy, smelly, perhaps, that unshakable message about their personal worth is something that might take a lot of practice or just a special kind of person to maintain.
Hello, I wish to register a complaint. Hello, miss?
What do you mean, miss?
Oh, I'm sorry, I have a cold. I wish to make a complaint.
Oh, sorry, we're closing for lunch.
Never mind that, my lad. I wish to complain about this parrot, what I purchased not half an hour ago from this very boutique.
Oh, yes, sir, the Norwegian blue. What's wrong with it?
I'll tell you what's wrong with it, my lad. It's dead. That's what's wrong with it.
No, no, it's resting. Look.
Look, my lad, I know a dead parrot when I see one, and I'm looking at one right now.
No, that's not dead. It's resting.
Resting?
Yeah, resting. Remarkable bird, the Norwegian blue, isn't it? Beautiful plumage.
The plumage don't enter into it. It's stone dead.
No, it's resting.
All right, then. If it's resting, I'll wake it up. Hello, Polly! I've got a nice fresh cuttlefish for you if you wake up Mr. Polly Parrot.
There he moved.
No, he didn't. That was you pushing the cage.
I didn't.
Yes, you did. Hello, Polly! Wakey, wakey! Rise and shine! This is your 9 o'clock alarm call! Now that's what I call a dead parrot.
No, he's stunned.
Stunned?
Yeah, you stunned him just as he was waking up. Norwegian blue stunned easily.
Oh, my lad, I've had enough of this. That parrot is definitely deceased. And when I bought it not half an hour ago, you assured me that its total lack of movement was due to it being tired and shagged out after a long squawk.
Well, he's pining for the fields.
Pining for the fjords? What kind of talk is that? Look, why did it fall flat on its back the moment I got it home?
Oh, well, the Norwegian blue prefers keeping on its back. Beautiful plumage.
Look, I took the liberty of examining that parrot, and I discovered that the only reason that it had been sitting on its perch in the first place was that it had been nailed there.
Oh, but of course it was nailed there. I mean, if I hadn't nailed it there, it would have muscled up to those bars and boom!
Look here, mate. This parrot wouldn't boom if you put 4,000 volts through it. It's bleeding demised.
No, it's pining.
It's not pining. It's passed on. This parrot is no more. It has ceased to be. It's expired and gone to see its maker. This is a late parrot. It's a stiff, bereft of life. It rests in peace. If you hadn't nailed it to the perch, it would be pushing up the daisies. It's rung down the curtain and joined the choir invisible. This is an ex-parrot.
Well, I'd better replace it then.
If you want to get anything done in this country, you've got to complain till you're blue in the mouth.
Sorry, Squire, I've had a look. We're right out of parrots.
I see. I get the picture.
I've got a slug.
Does it talk?
Not really.
Well, it's scarcely a replacement then, is it?
Listen, I didn't want to work in a pet shop. I wanted to be a lumberjack.
I'm sorry, this is irrelevant, isn't it?
Yes! A lumberjack! Leaping from tree to tree as they float down the mighty rivers of British Columbia. The giant redwood, the larch, the fir, the mighty Scotch pine.
What about my bloody parrot?
The smell of fresh-cut timber, the crash of mighty trees. With my best girl by my side, we'd sing, sing, sing.
I'm a lumberjack and I'm okay. I sleep all night and I work all day.
He's a lumberjack and he's okay. He sleeps all night and he works.
I want to throw this one in for you at the very end with a little bit extra focus, because Gestalt therapy, and specifically the Gestalt therapy practiced by this guy, Fritz Perls, is always a crowd pleaser. Fritz Perls and the Gestalt therapists were humanists. They were still humanists. They were existentialists and pretty focused on being phenomenologists as well. What does that mean? Well, a phenomenologist is focused on phenomenology. Phenomenology is the study of experience itself. So a phenomenologist, if they're studying a red ball, is not studying the compound of rubber or the paint or anything. They're studying what it is like to experience the redness of a ball. So the Gestalt therapists were all about what that person was experiencing, which is to say they were validating what it was that they were doing in existence. To exist is to experience. And so it was also very existentialist. You are in the process of existing in your world, which is nothing more than your experiences in it. So let's focus on that. Let's get into that. And let's strip away all the fakeness, all of the concerns, the superimposition of other people's expectations and your own diversion from yourself, and just be in whatever it is that you're experiencing and just stop pretending you're anything else out there in the world. So this actually became a fairly confrontational form of therapy. The therapist was very active. The therapist was challenging. When the therapist saw anything that you were doing that looked like it was a cover-up or was a diversion or it was fake or it wasn't genuine, their job was to call you out on it and get you focused on what it is that you were genuinely feeling in that moment. Their purpose at the end of it all was to integrate all of the things that were kind of being shattered and thrown out of yourself back into a genuine whole that was you and that was your experience. One of the things that Perls said was that we have a tendency to be different versions of ourselves to meet the expectations of different people. And so one of the things that was very popular for him to do would be to ask people to switch their roles into the position of another person. So you'd be sitting and having a conversation with them and you say, okay, now you play me. What? Now our roles are switched. How do you feel being inside me? And they would occupy you for a while and then they go back to their own seat. And they would in that way kind of take the experience that they were trying to give the therapist or trying to give their family or trying to give their friends by switching roles with that person, family member, friend, experiencing life from their point of view, their shoes, and then switching back, they kind of reclaimed themselves, the version of themselves that they were trying to put into the head of another person. That the technique that was very famous for Perls to do that was called the empty chair, where you maybe speak to somebody who wasn't there as if they were sitting in a chair and have a conversation with them that you couldn't really have in real life, and then swap those roles and swap them around. But Perls made a lot of really interesting videos around the 60s with people who were willing to come in front of an audience or in front of a group and have their experiences filmed. So I'm just going to share one of those with you that has a lot of this role swapping and position swapping to get somebody very short term over their stage fright.
Right now, we are in a studio, and we just talked about the stage fright. As Gestalt therapy is exclusively interested in the now, and our aim is to learn to cope with whatever happens. And right now, what happens is a certain amount of stage fright. So let's sample a bit. Will you take the hot seat? And to tell me how you experience your stage fright.
My hands are very cold and wet.
Yeah.
Very wet. And I have this little paper.
Can you imagine doing this to me?
Tearing you?
Yeah.
Yes.
I can't tear me apart.
I'm scared to death. I'm scared of you,
I guess. Put me in that chair.
Can I talk to you?
Yes.
I guess I'm afraid because I think I'll do something to myself because I know you aren't going to do anything to me. But I really am afraid of you.
Okay, now switch over to the camera. Say this to the camera.
I really am afraid of you.
Now, change, play the camera. Sit down here and play the camera. What would the camera answer? If you had some words, some feeling as camera, what would you say? Talk to that girl that was so frightened.
I see you sitting there. I see you nervous. I see you unsure. I see you as okay.
Now be yourself again. What would you say? Go on with the dialogue.
I feel better. I'm not so concerned right now. I feel more at ease.
Yeah. You see, this always happens. If you assimilate some of the projection and you realize what you're dealing actually only with a fantasy, something you invest, and if you take back what you have given up, whatever energy or experience you have disowned, given to the world, and it becomes your own, then you grow. You integrate this foreign material.
Okay. And that's all that we have for today. I will see you when I post another video on Wednesday morning at end of Tuesday for Wednesday. That'll be part two of the chapter 13 lectures. And again, your quiz is not due until next Monday night, but it will be followed up pretty quickly by the exam on that a week from Wednesday. All right. Take care.